Good afternoon. We're here this afternoon to talk about operational resilience, which is a subject which is becoming increasingly dear to our fine UK regulators, the PRA and the FCA. I am joined by my good friend Kelvin Ceberg from KA2. My name is Phillip Buckingham. I'm a managing director at MPAC Group, which is part of Laven. And we're here to give you a starter pack for how you as a firm need to think about operational resilience and some of the steps that you might wish to take on how you comply with the obligations that you're going to have to comply with by the 31st of March next year. We've therefore put together a short question and answer session, which will enable you to take some first steps in thinking about this complex subject. And Kelvin, I will be posing the questions, and Kelvin will be giving you the answers. So, Kelvin, the regulators have brought in the concept of operational resilience to improve the resilience of investment firms and other financial services firms, and also the financial markets to severe but plausible events of disruption. So, what is the difference between an existing BCP and DR and operational resilience?
So, Philip, that's a great question. BCP DR are traditional disciplines used by firms to manage, plan for, and to react to incidents that occur. Operational risk also falls into this category. Operational resilience is, as defined by the FCA, is the ability of firms to react to, learn from severe but plausible, as you mentioned, disruptive events. That's a slightly different take to the traditional disciplines of BCP, DR, which have standardised frameworks, which also have structures around them and are more organised in that sense. The FCA's definition of operational resilience is less structured around that. The other thing that's really important to understand about operational resilience is it's very, very much customer focused. You're now talking about something which is viewed from the customer perspective, whereas the traditional disciplines are often viewed from internally within the organisation.
Excellent. Thanks, Kelvin. I think that's probably a function also of the fact that those firms that are going to be captured by this compliance obligation are all customer-facing firms.
Yep, I agree with that.
Kelvin, previously, individual areas which may or may not be siloed within a firm have largely been responsible for the continuity of the individual area in the event of disruption. But with the new regulation, whose responsibility will operational risk be within a firm?
So with the advent of this regulation, there's been quite a significant change in the way that the FCA are looking at responsibilities for operational resilience within a firm. They've raised this to board level. They're expecting operational resilience to be a topic which is raised to board level. That means that they're expecting to see deficiencies in operational resilience capability raised to board level so that their investment decisions can be made by the board to address those deficiencies. Firms are also being asked to define what their important business services are and also the things that support those important business services, such as people, technology, premises, and third parties. firms are then being asked to assign the responsibility for operational resilience within the firm. Now, the way in which they do that can be in a number of different methods. They could use job descriptions, they could use or create a centre of excellence to do it. They could do it in some other method that they currently do. However, one of the things that's really quite key is operational resilience crosses all aspects of the firm, all different areas. So how that responsibility is assigned, given that it's got to be raised to board level and needs to board level investment decisions, is something that firms really need to think about. Firms are also being asked as an outcome to be able to deliver and embed business services that are going to eventually improve customer outcomes in the event of a disruption.
Thanks, Kelvin. So, given the imminent changes to the regulation and also to the emphasis of operational resilience as it was in the past, how important is data to a successful operational resilience program?
So, this is quite an interesting question to answer. And the reason being is that accurate data has often been absolutely key to a lot of traditional disciplines such as BCP, DR, operational risk in terms of those elements to it, and also to the business as a whole. So, you know, that not having accurate data creates problems for traditional disciplines. For operational resilience, that problem gets magnified. The reason that it gets magnified is that operational resilience also focuses in on the operational resilience of third parties and their capability as part of the important business services that you as a firm deliver. That creates some challenges about how you measure a third party's capability within operational resilience, and also how contractually, through SLAs or however that's achieved, that's actually set up. And, you know, how does that work overall? It's quite a difficult thing to make work. It's not something that's in SLAs with most companies at the moment. Operational resilience also comes across for another couple of areas where data becomes key. Data becomes key in the concept that the FCA would like firms to do in terms of self-assessment of their operational resilience capability. So not just in doing scenario testing and all the other bits and pieces, but that's part of it, but also in the event of a real disruption, because firms need to be able to understand whether or not they stay within impact tolerances. And if they do stay within impact tolerances, that's great. And if they don't, they need to be in a position to know that as soon as possible.
Thanks again, Kelvin. So by the 31st of March 2022, firms must have identified their important business services, set their own impact tolerances, and carried out mapping and testing exercises. In your opinion, therefore, what are the real challenges facing firms in designing, implementing, and embedding operational resilience into their firms?
Wow, Phillip, that's a pretty big, broad question there. So maybe I'll try and break down the answer into a bit of a structure and into groups, basically. So if we talk about people, first of all, as one group, you've got the situation where have people in the organisation, the firm, got the resources and the capabilities to be actually able to deliver operational resilience? Are they being set up to succeed? We've got an issue with operational resilience that when I've been speaking to different areas of the business, so maybe the technology side or sometimes the compliance side or the board, the language that people use around operational resilience isn't the same. If you look at some of the more traditional disciplines, they have a common language and a common framework. Operational resilience doesn't have that at the moment. Clarity about what people mean about operational resilience and the aspects about operational resilience is really important. And I think it's a really, you know, dangerous area if there isn't clarity around that. I think from a program perspective, if we're defining, if an organization is defining and building programs to solve operational resilience, it's very easy for organizations to drop into fixing the problems that are there, all the data problems that are there, defining all the business services, rather than focusing on what's really important. Not just important from an operational resilience perspective, in the sense of overall, you know, important business services, but also it needs to be proportional and important for the firm in the way that they develop, you know, deliver those services to their customers. That's an important bit. And the other little pitfall with the wonderful world of operational resilience is impact tolerances. The regulator talks about time being the minimum impact tolerance that people have to set. But in my case, probably money is the next one you probably want to look at. But going beyond that, it's very much a customer perspective. And that's quite a difficult area to actually work out what those impact tolerances should be and how you're going to measure them and whether you actually have the capability in the organization currently to measure them. One final point is tooling. There's a real question whether firms have got the correct tooling to support operational resilience. They've often had the tooling to support the traditional disciplines, but because operational resilience presents such a different view of how business services are delivered to customers, there's a real question of whether their tooling is actually up to the job or not.
Thanks again, Kelvin. So, firms are being asked by the regulators to conduct testing. But what scenarios do firms actually need to plan for?
That's a very good question, Phillip. So from my perspective, I think firms need to be pragmatic and sensible about the scenarios that they plan for. I would suggest picking one of a scenario which involves people, or a scenario that involves technology, or a scenario that involves premises, or perhaps one that involves a third party. And doing all the testing around that one scenario. Obviously, the one people, the current one with COVID is an absolute, you know, good one to start with, but people know what happens in that. So it's a good way of testing whether the way in which you're testing comes to the same outcome that's happening at the moment. Ultimately, a range of those is definitely best, picking them or having something that impacts multiples of them. But first of all, practice at the getting one right and then moving that further upwards. The other thing that's worth remembering about any of these testing scenarios is that it's worth thinking about how what happens in the real world. So, you know, what would the customer communications be like? What does that involve in other aspects of operational resilience as well? And that's, you know, it'd be just a way of ensuring that you are giving the right message to your customer, making sure they're informed and they understand what's happening.
And finally, Kelvin, what would your top tips be for ensuring and delivering successful outcomes?
So my first big top tip is to make sure that the definition of those outcomes is really clear, really well agreed, and really well defined in general. It's really important that people understand and have the same understanding of those outcomes. That's absolutely critical. The other thing that's really important is to remember that operational resilience and the way about which you go about it is effectively a process. So it's important that people go through the whole of the process from end to end, learn from going through that process, make adjustments as they go through, make adjustments for another cycle to ensure that the going through the process is delivering the artifacts to, and the framework that can be used to show how that firm is progressing in operational resilience and their operational resilience journey.
Thank you very much, Kelvin. That was a very interesting session. If anybody is interested in taking this discussion on operational resilience to the next step, we would be in a position to deliver a workshop on a firm-wide basis with as many or as few participants within a firm as necessary. And in order to do so, please contact either Kelvin at KA2 or myself, Phillip Buckingham, at Impact Limited, which is part of the Laven Group. And thank you very much for watching.